Welcome back to the County Seat. Our conversation today is on the flooding threat that's facing Utah right now. We've had a report from Terry Wood that's filled us in on where we are, and now we're going to look to the future through the crystal ball with our distinguished panels of guests. Joining us from Weber County Emergency Management is Lance Peterson. We have Kerry Gibson, who is a Weber County Commissioner, and Scott Baird, who is, it's a long title now, this is the Salt Lake County Engineering and Flood Control Division Director.
Right.
Boy, your business cards must be really crowded. So, Scott, we were talking prior to this about Salt Lake County, okay? You guys got a good road test back in 83.
Right.
And a lot of changes took place in flood control since mm-hmm. then. If water spills over the bank and fills up people's basements, does that mean that all of that engineering was a failure?
Well, we can do a lot of improvements on the channels and improvements to our flood control system. There does come a point when the channels just can't hold any more water. I would say, you know, the most significant and important improvement that we've made have been debris removal facilities at the mouths of the canyons. A lot of the time, the channels can carry the water, but then they get clogged with debris. And they lose their capacity, and that's what happened. Everybody remembers the flood coming down State Street in 83. That was because of the City Creek culvert in North Temple plugged with debris. So those debris removal structures are our most important facility to prevent flooding in subsequent years.
You would say then that Salt Lake's the drainage, the health of the drainage here is in pretty good shape then.
As far as the facilities and the improvements we've made, it's better than it's ever been. There are still improvements that need to be made, but we're more prepared this year than we've ever been. Our Public Works Department and the planning that's gone into just addressing this year and then capital improvement projects that we've done since the floods of 83.
When we were talking, Lance, a little bit earlier, you said that the health of the Webers not quite as good up in your neck of the woods.
No, it's not. The Weber River presents some really unique problems and complicated problems and issues. We think that since 1983, which was the last time it flooded, that the river has silted in significantly. The river, it's quite flat out there in western Weber County. The river meanders for probably 8 miles over about a 3 to 4 mile span. So you can tell that it really meanders through there. And it slows down. It enters the Ogden Bay Bird Refuge. That water slows down there. It's flat. There's a levee out there that we had the Department of Wildlife Resources breach earlier last month for us. It just slows down, silts in, and we believe that there's probably 450,000 cubic yards of silt in that 8 mile span that has decreased or diminished the capacity of that river to carry water. A case in point would be to prove that is that in 1983, the river levee broke at around 6,000 cubic feet per second, mm-hmm. 6,000 CFS. And this year, we're around 4,700 CFS, and we're overtopping the levee. One of the farmers I was talking to a couple of weeks ago said, when I was young, I used to have to swim my horse across the river in the summertime. Now I can walk across it because
wow.
of the silt. So significant problems down there.
Well, Commissioner, the lay of the land out in western Weber County, what's at risk here? I mean, if we go over those boundaries, you know, a lot of people, unless they live right out there, they don't know what's, you know, what kind of impact. Is that going to be like a national emergency area? Or?
Well, obviously, you're correct when you state that unless you live there, you don't really feel the impacts. And that's true with really any disaster. And we're trying our best to get the word out and let people know what our residents are struggling with. And obviously, our first priority is to protect homes. We want to make sure that individuals, maybe their most personal possession, well, and most of their most personal possessions are in their homes. It's very important that we do everything we can to protect those residences. But we also have a lot of industry in the area in agriculture, and agriculture is a significant player in the Weber County economy, as it is in the economies of many states. And in particular, that area has a lot of dairy farms. that depend on that cropland to produce the feed for those dairy cows.
Because I was concerned you were going to tell me the cows couldn't swim.
But, yeah, well, we've tried that. It's not working too well. But the reality is a disaster like this represents a significant loss to our agricultural community. And when that money, when the farmers have the expense, all the expenses of running a business and then have no way to realize the income from that business, it becomes a real challenge. And that's money that's then not recirculated back into our economy time and time again. We have a lot of our agriculture producers out there who may never recover from something like this because the losses will be so heavy. It'll be something that we'll see generations worth of equity eroded and literally washed away within a short period of time. Many of them have barely recovered from the 1983 floods, and as you know, the agricultural economy in Utah has struggled over the last several years anyway, and so they're already at a breaking point, and something like this has the ability to be a real dagger.
Where's that point where you say, okay, we're prepared for this level of disaster to protect people, but it costs money to do? How do you figure that formula out? And I'll just toss that out to all three of you.
In Salt Lake County, our standard is to improve the natural channels to the 100-year event. And so whatever the statistical 100-year flow or the 1% annual chance flow is, we try to design our channels and all of the culverts that carry water under the roads to carry that flow. And that's our standard, and that we use that because that's what FEMA uses in their flood zone mapping.
Okay, so here's my quick follow-up question. Are we going to be over that this year with the snowpack that's around those canyons?
Well, it depends on the creek. Some of our creeks in Salt Lake County we've already peaked on some of those lower elevation creeks. Some of the larger ones with the higher elevations like Big and Little Cottonwood, we could push that range.
Okay, for you guys.
Well, we definitely may be over that as a whole. The numbers that we recently received showed that March, April, and May, that three-month period, has been the wettest in history. So, at least since we've been keeping track. So we know that we're exceeding moisture levels. What we do have is better control upstream with our dams and reservoirs, and we hope that will mitigate some of these challenges.
So we will continue our conversation here on The County Seat. We'll be back in just a minute to talk about the flooding situation in northern Utah. Stay with us.
St. George, Utah was recently named TripAdvisor's number one travel hotspot. And travelers picked Zion National Park as the best national park. If you haven't planned your St. George or Zion getaway yet, visit atozion.com and find out why everyone else is already packing. St. George, Utah, everything from A to Zion.
What is play? Is it culture? Is it adventure? Is it...
Ooh, it's a destination.
Oh, yeah,
that's correct.
Cedar City and Brianhead Resort in the heart of Iron County, where outdoor excitement, culture, and the iron industry melts together. Come and forge a new adventure where play is the thing. You haven't forgotten how to play. It's just that you haven't been to the right place yet.
Take a look. Take a glimpse. Take a peek. You'll be surprised by what you find. Check us out at DeseretPeaComplex.com. Our phone number is 435-843-4020. Adventure, beauty, excitement. Tooele County Parks and Recreation, bringing communities together.